I like how that's all I have to say.
I watched the American one.
All right, so welcome back.
No, no, for a win.
GSS, and this will be the last GSS this semester.
Oh, yeah?
I appreciate you being, next semester. Just... Anyway, today I'm happy to have Giovanni to talk about some analysis. I guess. Semigroup.
That's perfect. It's okay. Alright, thanks for the introduction. So as I mentioned in the abstract, I have a PDE problem I want to solve today, but that is more an excuse to talk about other things. So I'm going to write down the problem, and I'm going to state the theorem that I want to prove, but then we're just going to forget about the problem, talk about interesting things that can be used elsewhere, and at the end, we'll probably be able to talk about the problem a little bit more. So the PDE I want to solve is the following one. So we let omega continue in Rn. Since I'm only interested in in problems that are interesting from the physical point of view, I'm going to assume that n is either 1, 2, or 3. And omega is an open bounded set, and we want the boundary to be sufficiently nice. So with, let's say, smooth boundary. Anything that allows you to solve an elliptic equation is fine. So Lipschitz is then we fix a topic. We have a parameter alpha in 0, 1. And the problem I want to solve is 1 minus alpha ut. So u is it's a function of two variables, x and t. X is like a space variable and t is time. So ut is the derivative with respect to time. So 1 minus alpha derivative with respect to time equals to the Laplacian. Laplacian of W. This is just the trace of the action, right? And alpha ut equals.
What's W?
W is a function.
No. You just said something is the trace of what?
The Laplacian is the trace of the action.
Okay.
That's what it is, right?
I thought you were saying something about something.
No. Laplacian of u plus f of u plus w. And I want these two equations to be satisfied for x in omega and t positive.
And what is f of u?
F is just a function of u, and I'm going to give an explicit formula for that in a second. Then we have boundary conditions u equal to w equal to 0. And I want this one to be satisfied of boundary condition. So for x in the boundary omega and t positive. And we also have an initial condition. So at time 0, u of x 0 is equal to u 0 of x. So again, this is for x in omega. So the unknowns are u and w, and the data of the problem is the set omega, the initial condition u0, and the force f. So what I'm going to assume on u0 and f is that the first assumption is on f, and I want f to be a polynomial in u. So f of u is equal to the sum of j from 0 to 2n minus 1 of bj u to the power j. And I want b to n minus 1 to be negative. And I'm also going to require that little n is equal to 2 when the dimension is equal to the dimension of the domain is equal to 3. These assumptions over here they're not very important from like the analytic point of view. They are there because of the like physical meaning of the problem.
Is that power of you or just effect?
Sorry, UJ? U to the power J.
Okay.
It's a polynomial. Yeah, as you might have noticed, like the reason why I want the last one to be negative is that, for example, take n equal to 3, like a polynomial that satisfies this is x minus x to the power 3, which is the derivative of the double left vector, right? So this is somewhat the typical expression for, well, I should say u. This is somewhat the typical expression that you have to keep in mind for you. Okay, and the next beam is a condition on the initial data, U0. I want to U0 to be beam H10 omega. So this is the space of a square integrable function that have a distribution of the derivative u prime, which is in gradient, let's say, which is in L2, and u is equal to 0 on the boundary of omega in some sense. The theorem that I want to prove is a well closeness theorem. So I want to prove that under these two assumptions, I can guarantee the existence and the uniqueness of a solution to the problem. So if 1 and 2 are satisfied, then there exists a unique and, I'm going to say, classical solution.
What's the reason for, if I add those two first equations together, right, and I have an equation in UT, just one equation, right?
Right.
So why do I want two equations?
That's exactly what I'm going to talk about in a second. I have a solution for B. And I should mention that what classical means shouldn't be here. It's something I'm going to define at some point. So yeah, as Tom was noticing, so first, you cannot decouple the system, right? But you know, it's worth like spending some time to look at this problem. And you can think of alpha as like interpolating something. And it's interpolating the equations like at alpha equals 0 and alpha equals 1. When alpha is equal to 0, then you can solve for W in the second one. And say W is equal to minus not plus of U minus F of U. And you can plug this thing into the first one and get 1 minus alpha plus alpha, but alpha is 0. So UT is equal to the Laplacian minus Laplacian minus F of U. And this one I can divide. And this one is the classical Cahn-Hilliard equation. When alpha is equal to 1, this first term disappears. So we get that the Laplacian of W is 0. But then we also have that W is 0 on the boundary of omega. And so by uniqueness of solutions to the Laplacian equation, we get that then W is constantly equal to 0. And if W is constantly equal to 0, the only equation we are left with is one here, which is, now alpha is equal to 1, so it's UT equals the Laplacian of U plus F of U. And this one is a semi-linear field equation. So this system is interpolating between a second order semi-linear equation and a fourth order semi-linear equation. right? It's far harder because I have the composition of the Laplacian, so I have four spatial derivatives. And this is another like reason why this problem was considered in the first place. This problem is very well understood, while this one is more complicated. So there might be hope to get something about this problem by taking limit over alpha that goes to zero of things that you can say about this problem. That's a very big idea.
This notion that you have of interpolating, it's very vague to me, right? It seems like
it is very vague.
I mean, what does it mean? Like, it's what it's supposed to represent, like this interpolation.
It does not represent anything. Like, it's a system that depends on alpha. When alpha is zero, you get an equation that is well known, it has a name. When alpha is one, it's another equation.
Right.
But you can consider it this system, right? Is there any reason why you would not consider it this system?
Well, I would only consider any system if there was a reason to. That's my reason.
As I said, there is a reason. And it has, like, very... Like, it has a physical meaning. You can derive this one with a limit from the field equations, which I don't really know what they are, but it comes up in places. But as I said, that's not the aim of my class. I want to, like, I have a problem that I can solve with the techniques I want to solve. Okay, is there any other question? About the tools I'm going to introduce. Let's first consider the case in which the Banach space is a Euclidean space Rn, and we're given a matrix, an n by n matrix A. So we all know that if we look at the differential equation u prime of t equals to A u of t, and u of 0 equals to 0 in Rn, then the solution to this problem is e to the ta of y to 0. And so what we want to do, like the game we want to play, is to have a way of defining something that, in a sense, behaves like the exponential of the matrix or of an operator, in our case. The way you define the exponential of a matrix is already a good way of defining this object for bounded operators. The way you define this thing for a matrix is you define e to ta as the using power series, right? So the sum of k from 0 to infinity of ta over k vector. And it's clear that we can extend this definition to linear bounded operators in the following way. So if we have now a generic Banach space X, and we have the ODE u prime of t equals to a u of t, and u of 0 is equal to u 0 from x, with a from x to x linear bounded, then the same definition works, and we can define this operator a e to the ta. And if you apply this operator to the initial data u 0, then you can show that this actually solves the problem. And it's interesting to notice that as soon as you can make sense of something like this, you can actually solve much more complicated problems. For instance, since we're interested in semi-linear problems, we can also consider the case in which we have f of s, u of s. And in this case, the solution will be given by the differentiation of constants method, right? We can define u of t as e to t a u 0 plus the domain term, so the integral from 0 to t of e to the t minus s j f of s u of s ds. Okay, so this solves the problem in the case that A is a linear bundle over A. But of course, the interesting case is, as usual, the complicated one. So we want to solve PDEs, right? So our operator A is going to be some differential operator. And differential operators are known to be unbounded, right? So we have to be able to say something about the case in which A is unbounded. Okay, and so I hope that this motivates the definitions that I'm going to give. Assume that X is a complex Banach space. And we have an operator A from D of A, which is the domain of the operator, thinking that is itself. And what we assume on A is that is closed and densely defined. The domain of A is dense in X. So the definition I was about to give before is the following one. So A family say T of T, where T is a positive, is called a semigroup if, so we want T of T to go from X to S and be bounded, this one is variety, and we want T of 0 to be the identity map on X, so we want T of 0 of U equal to U for every U in X. We want T to satisfy a semigroup law, so something of the form T of T plus S equals to T of T times DS. We want this one for every T and S positive. And T, we also would like to have a map that takes T into T of TX to be continuous for every x in x. So a family of operators that satisfies this property is called the semigroup. And this is the object that is going to play the same role of the exponential of the matrix. So the question might be, okay, when I have the exponential of a matrix, like, I also have like the matrix I started with, right? So is there anything that looks like this matrix A that is related to that family of semigroups? And the answer is yes, and it's what is called the infinitesimal generator of a semigroup. So definition. I should just divide this definition, I guess. So if you have e to the t a, how do you get a? You take a derivative and you evaluate at zero, right? So a. So we want to mimic the same thing. The way we do this for an unbounded operator is we define the domain of A first. We define this to be the set of all x in x for which the limit as t goes to 0 from the right of t x minus x. T exists. And once we have the set of points for which we can take this limit, we're going to define A of X to be this quantity here, this for X. So exactly the same thing we can do in this case. We're here, but you have to be a little bit careful because you have to, like, there is no guarantee that this limit is going to exist for every X in X. Okay, and we say that A is called the infinitesimal generator of the family T of T. Okay, I should mention that usually in applications, you have the PDE, which you write as an ODE, and in the ODE, you have A, you don't have T of T. So what, like, usually, like, what you want to do is to, like, given A, you want to be able to find the operator, the semigroup that is generated by A. And there is, this is not always possible. It's not true that given any operator A, there is a, that A is a generator for a semigroup. So we have to restrict our attention to like a smaller class of operators for which we can say something more. We say that operator A, T of A into X, is called a sectorial operator with angle delta if there exists a positive delta which is below pi over 2, for which the sector S delta plus pi over 2 minus 0 is containing the resolvent of A. So this one is the resolvent of A, so it's the this is the subset of the complex plane of those lambda for which lambda I, lambda identity minus A is invertible. And this object here is a sector in the complex plane, and this is the opening angle of the sector. So for instance, S omega would look like, so we have an omega here, and it's this set here. In this case, we have delta is positive, and we're adding pi over 2, so it's going to look like this delta. So this is delta plus pi over 2, and this whole set is contained into the resolvent of A. So this is a way of saying that the spectrum of A is somewhat confined to this sector here. and the spectrum of A's, like, is the set of points for which species not in kernel, essentially. So it's like saying the bad set is confined in something that we have control. And what plays a really important role is the space that we have, is the space that we have there. And this is going to be clear from the next definition. But like you play a lot with this extra space you get here. I should also say that we need an estimate on the resultant operator. So for every epsilon positive, this is still part of the definition, there exists a constant m epsilon such that the norm of lambda a, so it's the inverse of this guy, is less than or equal than m epsilon over absolute value of lambda, where the length of lambda. And this is true for every lambda different from zero, with lambda in s delta plus pi over 2 minus epsilon closed. So in a slightly smaller set. So you want to be epsilon apart from the other set. When z is equal to 0, and 1 over 2 pi I d in over the curve gamma of e to the lambda z r lambda a d lambda. And this is for all z in s delta. The reason for this is that if you look at this picture, so if this is delta, then S delta is this one. So any Z in S delta has positive real part, right? And what I want from gamma is to do something like this. I want gamma to go to infinity, like in this region here, go back here, and then go to infinity over there. In this way, I have that the real part of z is positive, but the real part of lambda is negative. So that the real part of this number is going to be negative, and I get convergence of this integral. And so you come up with this map, and what you say about this is that you can build few properties. So I can erase this. So what you can prove is the map that takes z into t1.
Was it r?
Sorry, was